And we're back again for module four. Hopefully you've enjoyed all the modules so far. You've had a chance to look at managing your SQL servers in the enterprise and managing the server configuration. You've had a chance to look at security and the security architecture and how to plan security and design a security solution. And in the previous module, we looked at backup and restore, which are obviously a key part of being a DBA. In terms of making sure that your database is recoverable in the event of a disaster. Yeah. What we want to look at in this module is, if we're thinking there might be a disaster, how can we try and mitigate that and keep the database upline as much as possible? So, Christian, if I can just ask you to tell us a little bit about what we're going to cover in this module.
Great, thank you. So this module is around high availability. So we're specifically talking about high availability technologies that are available to SQL Server. We'll start off talking about log shipping. Now, log shipping is a very say old, I think mature is probably a better word for a
well-established
technology. Yes. And then we're going to talk about Windows Server failover clustering as a Windows technology before moving on to see to look at our first always-on technology for this session, which is failover clustering. So we're separating out the Windows element from the SQL Server element.
Okay.
And then we're going to talk about availability groups, which again is one of these big headline features for high availability. And we'll get a chance to talk about exactly what it is, how it works, and we'll have a chance to kind of build it out and talk through that.
Okay.
And then finally, we'll talk through some advanced deployment scenarios that have come from the work that we've done as consultants in the field about looking at customers' requirements and developing creative solutions based on these technologies.
Okay, well, great. It sounds like there's a lot to look at. Let's start with, as you say, the established technology, log shipping.
So log shipping is essentially the process of shipping off a transaction log backup to another server and continually restoring those. So we looked at backup and recovery in the previous module. And what we're doing, instead of having these backups to disk or backup going to Azure, we're sending it across to another server, and we're maintaining that without recovery so we can continually apply extra logs. So within SQL Server, there's a log shipping wizard, so that's a lot more sophisticated. As a concept, you could build it out yourself, mm-hmm. but SQL Server has a log shipping wizard to set up the primary and the secondary and the process and to enable it to keep track of log backups and to recover a lot quicker than you would if you were doing it all yourself.
And I guess it's important to point out that this is a high availability solution at the database level. It's an individual database.
Yeah,
we're
absolutely
backing up the transaction log for that database. And then if you remember from the previous module, we talked about that a transaction log backup is actually just a record of the transactions that have happened. So we then replay those transactions on the same database on a different server in order to keep it in sync effectively.
Yeah, exactly. So it's very well-established technology, as we've already mentioned. And the reason that it's still popular today is because it's very easy to set up. It's easy to understand the underlying technology and therefore troubleshoot things when things go wrong. And it's essentially cheap. Mm. You know, and so some of the another benefit for this over the other technologies that we'll look at is that you can multicast, you can log ship to as many destinations as you wanted to have availability for. But when we look at the other technologies, you start to get a few kind of restrictions on that. So we definitely still use log shipping when we're running architecture workshops to come up with solutions. And those types of scenarios, we've got lots of destinations that we require. We may have a delayed restore requirement. Mm-hmm. So some of the classic scenarios for this are the log ship destination is 4 hours behind, just in case there's a mistake, that so we don't want that flowing through the entire system there.
Oh, okay. And I guess one other thing to say is those secondary servers we're shipping to, with some caveats, they can be readable. So I could offload some reporting to those servers.
Absolutely.
They can become read-only copies of the
Absolutely.
Database.
So you can make those log ship secondary readable with the caveat that when we log ship another log, you either need to delay the restore of the log, and impact your availability, essentially, or your data loss, or you need to kick the users out. So the users, the data that the users will be reading will be based on the last transaction log backup.
Okay.
If that makes sense.
Yep. Good. All right, so that's log shipping. It's been around for a long time, and if you've been working with SQL Server, you're probably already familiar with it. Moving to something that's not a SQL Server technology, this is a kind of foundational technology within Windows itself, and that's failover clustering. So
yes,
talk us through that.
So the reason for including Windows Server clustering within SQL Server and the exam syllabus is because the always-on technologies, which we'll talk about shortly, are built on top of Windows Server failover clustering. So a server failover cluster includes what we call cluster nodes. Clustered resources would be disks and services like SQL Server, and clustered roles, and a role would be an instance of SQL Server. So each node, so we have a cluster of nodes, a cluster of servers, and they communicate with each other to tell each other their availability. So they'll periodically send out, I'm still here, are you still here, so they can detect whether one of them is out of service and maybe that they should start up and take those resources.
And this communication is what's commonly referred to as the heartbeat, isn't it? To make sure everything's still, all the nodes are still up and running.
Yeah, so the heartbeat process. So there'll be a heartbeat that's sent out every second across every network card that's enabled for cluster use that says, I'm still here, I'm still here. And it's the interruption of that process that starts to the chain of events that causes what we call failovers, which is resources moving from one node to another.
Okay. And I guess just to drill into the nodes, the nodes themselves are what we would think of as servers. It's a PC server, effectively. And then the resources that we've got, let's say there's a shared disk that's in perhaps in a SAN or whatever, that's a shared resource between the different nodes in the cluster. There's this concept of ownership as well.
How does that work?
So
if we have an instance of SQL Server, and we'll talk about how that works in a subsequent slide, each node will own a role, and a role is an application like SQL Server. It could be Exchange, it could be another cluster-aware application, and it has ownership of that role. If something were to happen to that node, that server, another node in the cluster would take ownership of that role and would start the resources required to move that across. So in the case of a shared disk, the shared disk is accessible by either node, but will only be reserved, so there'll be a SCSI reserve command, by one node or the other.
Okay. So I guess the key point really is that a Windows cluster is a mechanism. It's called a failover cluster, and it's a mechanism for high availability. It's redundancy. We're not talking scale out. We're not saying, hey, there's multiple servers, therefore we can do more work.
Absolutely.
It's a question of there's effectively a spare server, a redundant server that can take over ownership should the one that we're using fall down.
Exactly. And it's designed as opposed to log shipping, which is a manual failover technology. So we would use log shipping for disaster recovery, for example. So we want to control when we decide to push that red button to implement disaster recovery.
Mm-hmm.
Whereas failover clustering is designed to be automatic failover, so it's a high availability technology where we would move roles and resources between nodes on a fairly regular basis, actually, if not for just for maintenance purposes, that we can have a lot of uptime by moving resources to another node while we do some maintenance.
Perhaps patching a server or whatever
exactly,
it might be.
Yeah. Exactly. So it provides high availability for services.
Okay, fantastic. So that's the foundational piece of Windows.
Yes.
Now let's overlay SQL Server on top of that.
So we've got the next part still in Windows around quorum.
Yes.
Yeah, so it's really important when we start to look at availability groups to understand this concept of quorum. So a quorum in a cluster defines the minimum number of votes required for the cluster to remain online. So we have this this concept of quorum now. So if we have, for example, we had 8 nodes in a cluster, which isn't an unusual amount of nodes to have in a cluster, and they're all communicating with each other, if the first 4 nodes couldn't see the other 4 nodes, but they were both up and working, they just couldn't talk to each other, how would they know which set of four should be running all the resources?
Right.
So they don't know, and we call that a split brain scenario.
Okay.
So in order to avoid this split brain scenario, we have this concept of a quorum. So in that scenario, both say there were two different sites, four nodes in each site, mm-hmm. and this site connectivity link had gone down. Those four nodes would say, we can see each other, we've got four nodes and four votes, but there are eight nodes in this cluster and we don't have enough to form a quorum. So we will stop, and the other guys would do the same as well.
Okay.
So this is where we want to avoid having an even number of votes across a cluster, because it's much harder for us to reach majority or reach quorum.
So how then can I configure it? If I have got eight nodes in the cluster, how can I make sure there's an uneven number of votes then?
So this is where we would add, we have node majority, first of all. It's the quorum configuration that you can see on the slide. Mm-hmm. So this is where if you had an odd number of nodes, so you'd had seven nodes or nine nodes, we have a node and disk majority. So you add what we would traditionally call the quorum disk. Is also a voting mechanism here. Or you can do node and file share majority. So you're effectively saying use this file share as a vote in the stability of the cluster. So what we're aiming for here is to have an odd number of votes. So it's much easier for us to maintain a majority and keep everything running.
So, and just to be clear, the kind of disk and file share, what we're effectively saying is we have an even number of servers. We need something else that's connected to this network that can vote to say,
exactly,
to give us that number. So the file share, it's not that we're necessarily storing things in the file share or using it as a traditional file share.
Yeah.
It's not like log shipping where we're storing the transaction log there and copying it. It's literally just a resource connected to the network that then has a vote so that we can determine whether or not we have quorum.
Exactly. And how that vote works, it's a very, very lightweight operation in the fact that each node will essentially write to that file share. So when you go and read from the file share, you can see who else has written to it. Mm. And so it's this interim communication mechanism, so you can see who's up and running. Mm. Through that mechanism. But it's really important to understand this concept when we start to look at availability groups, because server failover clustering and the quorum and always-on failover clustering, which we're going to talk about, is based around high availability technologies. And we've got multiple uses for availability groups that we'll come and talk about.
Okay, great. So we've got a good understanding now of Windows failover clustering and the need to maintain quorum. Mm. Now, having peaked too soon earlier, now we're going to talk about overlaying SQL Server on top of that.
Yes,
so
yeah.
Tell us a little bit about that.
So failover clustering is now, since SQL Server 2012, is what we would call an always-on technology. So when always-on first came out, it was mostly associated with availability groups, but actually always-on is also failover clustering. So the proper name for failover clustering is always on failover clustering.
Okay.
So SQL Server is a cluster aware application. So when you install SQL Server on a Windows failover cluster, you will install a failover cluster instance of SQL Server, which is a different installation type to a standalone installation of SQL Server, which is predominantly what we've been kind of discussing and working on. All the demos have been on a standalone installation of SQL Server.
So right at the very beginning when I'm installing SQL Server, it's an option then to actually install as a clustered instance rather than a standalone instance.
Yeah.
And there's no way to migrate a standalone instance to a clustered instance.
So, and when you have a look in setup, you'd install a standalone installation, or you'd start the installation for a failover cluster installation. It's not an option during setup. You have to start.
You start that type of setup.
Yeah.
Okay.
So the big benefit for always-on failover clustering is that it's instance-level protection. So everything that everybody does on that instance subsequently to you building it is automatically protected.
So this is unlike, in contrast to log shipping, where we had an availability solution for a database.
Absolutely.
And if I wanted to protect multiple databases, I had to set up multiple log shipping scenarios.
Exactly.
And this is the whole instance.
Yeah, and technologies like log shipping, it doesn't synchronize logins, SQL Server agent jobs. There are lots of things that you need to do to transfer those artifacts over and keep them synchronized manually.
At the server level over and above the database.
For log shipping. Whereas with failover clustering, because it's the whole instance and everything on it, as consultants, it's great for us because we can build these fantastic solutions for customers, and everything they do afterwards is automatically protected by this high availability technology. They haven't got a list of things that they need to do every time they want to make a change. So it's a really robust, it's been around since NT4 days, Windows failover clustering, so it's been around for a long, long time, and it's evolved and advanced over the years, that's for certain. It's transparent to end user applications, so from if you an infrastructure person and you're working with a team of developers, you would give them a SQL Server instance name, and they don't really need to know that it's a failover cluster instance because their experience in connecting to that isn't going to really change, bearing in mind the fact that they'll need to monitor for disconnects and reconnects, but that should be a normal part of developing their application anyway.
And even at the networking level, I mean, it's got its own IP address that represents the whole
Absolutely.
Cluster. So, you know, from the point of view of being a resource on the network, it's conceived as one thing. It's one. I hesitate to use the term virtual server because that usually means something else. But it's a single entity. It's not multiple servers, and I have to pick which node is the active node. I go to the cluster, and whichever is the active node takes over.
Exactly. So you have this virtual IP address and virtual host name, and you will always connect to the virtual host name, and it will either be running on one of the nodes in the cluster. Mm. And you shouldn't really care or need to know which server you're running on, because they should all have an equal amount of resources available.
All right. Okay. Great.
So one last point on that I should have mentioned, always on failover cluster instances require shared storage. So they're based on Windows Server failover clustering. Windows Server failover clustering doesn't require shared storage, but a Windows failover cluster instance of SQL Server, which sits on top of a cluster, does require shared storage.
So in other words, when we say shared storage, what we're meaning is storage in the form of disks or a SAN that is accessible from all of the nodes in the cluster.
Exactly, exactly. So before, and it's important to note, but now we've got availability groups, we didn't need to have this differentiation when all we had was clustering. Mm. And we talked about SQL clustering, and we didn't really separate out the Windows part from the SQL part because it all just worked the same way. But now we do have to do it to understand how availability groups work.
Okay. All right. So with all of that in place, let's talk about some of the enhancements that have been made in the more recent versions of SQL Server. And if you're studying for the exam, these would be the versions that the exam is based on.
Absolutely. So there's a big enhancement for SQL Server 2012 was the way that SQL Server or the cluster handled the health monitoring failover policies. So we had what we call these looks alive and is alive checks. So a cluster aware application will tell the cluster within a resource DLL these two checks, so looks alive and is alive. What does my application do to look like it's alive and working? And for SQL Server, that used to be, is the service up and running, yes or no? And if that fails, so we do that every second, and then every 5 seconds, the cluster would do an is alive check. Now for SQL Server, the is alive check, the cluster would connect to the instance of SQL Server, and it would run select ATAT server name. And if a result was returned, then we're considering that the instance is alive and we'll leave it alone.
Okay.
So there were some problems with that in terms of if you think about this on a global scale, I mean, there are hundreds of thousands of deployments of those. And from a Microsoft perspective, this is a distillation of the support cases. So while problems with this, you or I may never see in our working life, it only takes a few hundred cases of this globally for it to be pushed up the priority list on Microsoft to do something about it. And we're going to talk about this diagnostics thing on the next slide, actually. So I'll move on and talk about this support for multi-subnet clustering. So multi-subnet clustering has been around in the operating system for a prior version. And it was only with SQL Server 2012 that we got support for multi-subnet cluster failover cluster instances.
So we're talking about IP networks that are subnetted into different subnets.
Yeah, exactly.
And having nodes on multiple subnets, is that?
Exactly. Okay. So the scenario that this enables us to do is to have cluster nodes in different data centers on different subnets, without having to, what we would previously have to do is to stretch a virtual network across both data centers so it looked like the same
subnet. Okay.
So it's really, really easy now for us to set up and build architectures between data centers for failover cluster instances and involving clustering.
And I think this is an interesting, an important point as well. We tend to, as people who create training materials or who speak to customers about clustering, we tend to always have that diagram with two little servers and a disk between them, and that's a cluster, and they're physically right next to each other.
Yeah.
And it can be quite often, if you haven't worked with this in reality, it can be tempting to believe, yeah, that's a cluster. That's it's a rack that's got two servers in it with a disk. In actual fact, those nodes could be geographically disparate. They could be in different locations.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Yeah, and we'll look at some examples of those towards the end of this module. So local tempdb was another great new feature in SQL Server 2012. So when you have a failover cluster instance of SQL Server that requires shared disk, if you remember, so we've only got one copy of the database, because when we fail over, that disk will move over to the other node. But if we think about tempdb and the use of tempdb, everything in tempdb goes when you restart SQL Server. So we effectively recreate tempdb every time SQL Server restarts. And the process of a failover between one node to the other is effectively a restart of SQL Server. So you're stopping it on one node, starting it on the other. So if you've got tempdb on an expensive sound drive and it moves over to another node, you're not keeping anything that it had on the first node, so it doesn't really need to be on shared storage.
So we could actually have it on locally attached storage to that node.
Exactly. And we used this technology to great effect to one customer, where there's a couple of scenarios for this. You can have very local, very fast local SSD storage, so you can get high throughput on tempdb by having it local to the cluster node. And the other scenario that we employed with one of our customers was they had a lot of IO traffic from tempdb on their SAN, and they were looking to buy a new SAN because they'd run out of performance capacity, so they peaked their IOPS. So we talked about IOPS with Resource Governor. And we were able to help them delay that purchase of a new SAN by removing all of these tempdb IOPS, by moving tempdb for all their clusters to local storage.
So you move the load from the SAN to the local storage.
Exactly. So there was no technical reason for tempdb to be sat on a shared disk. It was just, it wasn't supported any other way, but now it is.
Okay, so that was some great enhancements in SQL Server 2012, and then one reasonably significant enhancement in SQL Server 2014.
Absolutely. So clustered shared volumes, or CSVs, is a storage technology that was introduced in Windows Server 2012, I think it was. that basically enables you, so it was only for Hyper-V when it was first released in that version, so it enables multiple servers to access and read and write from the same disks at the same time. So the scenario was a virtualization scenario. So you had a disk in a failover cluster that's a clustered shared volume, and you had multiple virtual machines on that one disk, and those virtual machines could be running on any of the nodes in the cluster.
Okay.
Does that make sense? And that's what clustered shared volumes were all about. So then we had SQL Server 2014, and we've got Windows Server 2012 R2 now. So now we can use clustered shared volumes for failover cluster instances of SQL Server.
Okay.
The benefit of that for us is with a shared disk, traditional shared disk, it's got to be removed and attached and started again. Whereas with a clustered shared volume, all of the nodes are accessing the disks at
all
the same
time
anyway.
Okay.
So you should get faster failovers.
Okay, fantastic. So some enhancements that have been made to always-on failover clustering, which is the SQL Server technology built on top of Windows failover clustering. There's another one listed here, this SP Server Diagnostic Store Procedure, which I think you mentioned you were going to talk about more. So
yeah, exactly. So this is related to the health monitoring, the flexible failover policies and improved troubleshooting that the product group put into the product. And instead of having this looks alive, is alive process for select ATAT server name, there were problems with that in terms of you could have an outage based on the failure of a simple query. You could have that query being successful and nobody else can connect to the server. So you could have a lot of false failures, false positives. So there was significant opportunity for things to go wrong. And if you're promoting a high availability technology, it really needs to be highly available. So what they developed instead was this built-in store procedure called SP Server Diagnostics, which is used within the resource DLL for SQL Server to help the cluster determine whether the SQL Server is up and running, first of all, but it also allows you the flexibility to say what healthy means to you and your application.
So I can identify the level at which I want to trigger failover versus the level
exactly
of, hey, it's fine. I know there might be some errors, but I'm happy to tolerate that.
Yeah. So, and you can see on the slide that we have there, we have from 0 to 5. So we can configure a SQL Server instance with a failover policy of 0, which means don't fail over. Only fail over on server down. Only fail over on server unresponsive. And level 3 is the default level, so it's critical SQL Server errors, essentially, will cause...
I can't remember what error level number
so
that
it is. Will be... I'm not sure what the threshold is, but it'll certainly 20, yeah. 20, 22, 24, around that, as critical errors. And so the higher the number, effectively, the more sensitive the failover will be,
right
up to the very top one there, where you can actually trigger failover based on performance conditions. So my queries are running slowly, I want to trigger a failover.
Okay. Fantastic. So that's failover clustering.
Yes.
And there's a lot of aspects of that. And I think it's fair to say failover clustering is the kind of industry standard for highly available database servers. In most cases where you've got a real mission critical enterprise database solution, clustering is kind of the kind of core technology that you would use for failover clustering.
It's the default.
Yeah. But there's another option as well. We've got this other always-on technology availability groups, which again builds on Windows failover clustering. So just to be clear about that distinction. But this is not the same as SQL Server failover clustering. So talk me through this.
Exactly.
Then.
So the technology is called always-on availability groups. And in the diagram we have there at the moment, we have a Windows cluster. So it's a 3-node Windows cluster. And what's unique, or what I would like to draw your attention to with this, is that we don't have any shared storage on this Windows failover cluster. So it was commonly believed that clusters need shared storage. Clusters don't need shared storage. SQL Server clusters need shared storage, and this isn't what we're dealing with here.
So these nodes, we're going to have SQL Server on these. Each has its own local storage. And again, just to make the point, when we installed SQL Server failover clustering, we had to specifically install a clustered instance of SQL Server. It was a separate installation program. This isn't that. We're not installing a clustered instance. This is SQL Server as a standalone instance on each node.
Exactly. So we've got three nodes with local storage that just happen to be configured as a Windows Server failover cluster. We've got no resources. We've got no failover. It can't do anything at this stage.
Okay.
So, and what we've got is an installation of SQL Server, a local installation of SQL Server on each one of these nodes. Mm-hmm. And each one of these instances, it has no idea about the fact that it's on a failover cluster, really, because it's just a local installation of SQL Server. We've got three instances of SQL Server here. Then we, within Configuration Manager in SQL Server, you have to enable availability groups.
Okay.
And part of enabling that process, the configuration manager will check to see if the server that you're on is part of a failover cluster before it will let you enable it.
Okay.
So skipping forward there, so what we have is the three nodes, three instances of SQL Server. I have two databases on that middle instance there, which I've called ERP and CRM, so representing these ERP and CRM databases. Mm-hmm. And I've grouped them together into an availability group.
Okay. So this is multiple databases that I want to protect using this technology.
Exactly. So the grouping related databases.
Okay.
So now I'm going to define a replica of my availability group, which is a duplicate of the databases in my availability group, and I'm going to put that onto one of the other nodes.
Okay.
And you'll notice here that we've got synchronous. So synchronous means that any transactions that are written to the primary, so the middle one is the primary here, will be sent across to the replica and confirmation sent back before they're considered to be committed.
Okay. So I've got what's looking like a sort of hybrid combination between failover clustering in the sense that there's a Windows cluster involved. But actually, the mechanism for protecting the individual database, in some ways, it's analogous to log shipping. It's not the same technique. We're not actually shipping the transaction log, but effectively, we're repeating the same transactions that I've done on the primary server on a secondary.
You're moving log records. So whereas with log shipping, you're moving log backups. Mm-hmm. With availability groups, you're moving across individual log records. So the granularity is really, really small.
Okay.
And setting it up with synchronous means that we've got zero data loss between these replicas.
So these two will be maintained in sync all the time.
Okay. Exactly.
All right. Well,
so what we're doing the next stage here is creating what we call a listener. So a listener, an availability group listener, is this combination of a clustered network name and clustered IP address that you would see on a failover cluster instance of SQL Server. Mm-hmm. And this is what we would use to access the databases that were running in our availability group. And in the event of a failover from the middle node to the node on the right, my listener would automatically repoint to the node that was running the databases.
So now we're back to being a bit more like failover clustering in the sense that in a log shipping scenario, if I'm going to failover, my applications have to now point to the other server. They have to actually redirect their request to the other server that is now the primary.
Yeah.
Whereas in this case, again, we're transparent to the client. The client really doesn't care. It's using that that clustered network name and IP
address. And this is exactly why availability groups is built on top of Windows failover clustering.
Okay.
So we can manage the failover policies there.
Okay. Well, so far so good. So I've got my user who's accessing that shared that clustered network name and IP address. I notice I've got my third node in my Windows cluster, and he's not doing very much at the moment. So what might I want to do with him?
Shall we see? So what we're doing in the diagram here is we're creating another replica of our availability group on the third node. So you notice we've got three nodes. So we've got an odd number, so we can maintain a quorum with three nodes, which is good. And I'm using my third node as another replica, but I'm doing it asynchronously. So what I'm doing is it's a send and forget. So I'm sending out my log records, but I'm not waiting for confirmation for them to come back.
Why might I do that? Or why wouldn't I just do them all synchronously?
So it's purely performance reasons. So one of the things that we've found with the customers that we're setting this up is we would, wherever we can, we'll set things up synchronously and drop it back to asynchronous if it becomes a performance problem, because it's easier to drop back than it is to move up. From a performance and testing perspective. So the reason that asynchronous is faster is because you're not waiting for this return trip to say, yes, I've got it.
Okay.
But it has the potential for data loss.
Okay, so I'm maintaining another copy asynchronously. I'm replaying the same transactions on another. There is the potential that the middle node fails after it's applied a transaction that hasn't yet been sent across to the secondary. In the event of failover to that secondary, I could lose that those changes.
Essentially, yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Oh, I've gone backwards. There we go. So we've got another user now, and this user isn't going through the cluster network name. He's going straight to that third node.
So what we're depicting in the diagram here is one of the great benefits of availability groups is being able to use these additional replicas for reporting purposes. So what we can do is to configure that replica to be readable. In the same way we discussed with the log shipping secondaries, we can make this replica readable, but we don't need to kick the users out. We don't have this delay. So what we have is a near real-time view of the database that's readable for reporting purposes.
And that, I mean, I guess there's two purposes for that. One is that asynchronous link could be across to a different geographical location. So this could be a branch office having its own local readable reporting server. Mm-hmm. Or it could just simply be to take the workload off the primary and we're going to generate some reports, but we're going to do that on a secondary that's actually just a redundant copy anyway.
So a really effective scenario that we've used this in was for one of our customers is a travel company. Mm-hmm. And they have a very big, very high throughput transaction processing system, but they need to do operational reporting. They don't want operational reporting to affect their ability to sell holidays to their customers, but they still need to run off customer lists for who's getting on a cruise ship and who's being picked up at a coach stop, things like that. So what we were able to do is to set up availability group replicas. We've got an asynchronous replica, so now they can do all of this operational reporting directly off near real-time live data without impacting and blocking that we were looking at in the previous course, without blocking the writers.
Okay. So it occurs to me, if I can report off of these secondaries, is there any other workload I could take from the primary to the secondary? Is there anything else I could do from the secondary?
Absolutely. So we can also offload backups is a really clever feature that the product group spent a lot of time working on here, where you can take a copy-only full backup from a replica, and the only impact of that is that it doesn't reset the differential backups.
Okay.
But the key factor in this is that you can take a transaction log backup from any one of those three replicas, and it will synchronize the checkpoints across all of the other replicas.
Right. So actually, I could offload the overhead of performing backups onto one of the secondaries and without impacting the workload.
Exactly. But the benefit of this, the idea is that you would do all of your backups to a file share on the network, for example. So you didn't need to care which one of the servers did the backup as long as they all go to the same destination. So you could do backup on server 1, server 2, server 3, and they would be contiguous in terms of their the log backups and synchronized across all replicas.
So it really is a kind of, I know I'm emphasizing this, but I guess for people to get their heads around this, if you think of this as being a kind of continuum, at one end you've got something like log shipping, which is very much at the database level, two distinctly different servers that could be configured in all sorts of different ways, and all we're really doing is replicating the database on one across to the other by dint of restoring the log backup in giving us a redundant copy. At the other end of the extreme, you've got failover clustering, where conceptually it's one server, and even though there's multiple nodes, it's one clustered server that that has one instance of SQL Server shared across all of those nodes. And this is kind of somewhat, it's a sort of best of both worlds solution, I guess. It gives me the ability to offload some of that reporting workloads as if they were separate servers, because they are, but also conceptually from an applications perspective, treat them as one server like I would with a cluster.
Yeah, absolutely.
Okay.
So we've touched on a lot of the next few slides, actually. So if we just reiterate this point around synchronous commits. So whenever you have a synchronous replica, you're writing to the primary. The primary is sending log records to a secondary replica, but they're not considered committed until confirmation has come back from the secondary. And then the primary replica will commit the transaction. So inherently, that is going to have a performance overhead. But there are a lot of optimizations, and it is quite a fast process, and it's surprising how many scenarios that you could have synchronous replicas in. We've certainly got hundreds of databases running in synchronous mode and the customers that we manage.
Okay.
And moving again on to asynchronous commit mode. So the primary sends the log record to a secondary, but the secondary doesn't need to respond to say, I've definitely got it, you can commit. So it sends it and commits the result anyway.
Okay. And then we talked about offloading. We talked about the reporting offloading, the offloading the full and log backups as well. Mm-hmm. There is one other thing we didn't mention, and that's this. I've got to remember, we have an American audience as well, so it's a read-only routing to readable replicas, as opposed to read-only routing, which is what we'd say in the UK. So tell me a little bit about this read-only routing or routing.
So the idea behind read-only, read-only routing is that all of your connections would connect via this virtual network, this availability group listener. And if you specified within your connection string that effectively that you were going to do a read-only workload, it allows you to set up the infrastructure to route that connection to a readable replica within your availability group deployment. So in the scenario that we had in the diagram, we had one person connecting to a server to do his reporting, but what if that server went down?
Or what if it became the primary?
Exactly. So we want this dynamic environment where you don't need to know or care which server you're connected to, because you just provided a service. So it's moving towards this cloud-based model of you're provided a service and you don't need to know all of the details of what's happening underneath.
Okay. I guess the only thing to say is that this is contingent on the client application being able to specify, hey, I'm looking for a read-only connection.
Yeah.
And there's a number of ways you can do it. In the connection string, we can specify that the read intent is to have read-only access to the database. So I just want to query a table for reporting purposes. So you might, if you had reporting services set up, for example, you might make sure the connection string includes, it's going to be read-only because it's reporting services.
Yeah,
we're not
absolutely
updating anything. And that way it will be routed or routed away from the primary server to one of the readable secondaries, and again, remove that workload from the primary server.
Yeah.
Okay, so we talked a little bit about getting the thing set up and the multiple nodes and the business of sharing the workload across the replicas. What if something goes wrong? What if we need to fail over manually because we want to, you know, do some maintenance to one of the nodes, or if something happens to the primary node and it fails? Tell me a little bit about failover.
So we can set up a failover pair for automatic failover. So prerequisite to be configured for automatic failover is that you're synchronous. So you have to have synchronous replicas to be able to enable them to be a part of a failover pair. And that's really the high-end, high-availability, zero-data-loss deployment scenario is providing this automatic failover piece. We also have the ability to do planned manual failovers without data loss. So if you've got two synchronous replicas, a primary and a secondary, you could switch who was the primary and who was the secondary without any fear of data loss. And it's a very simple, quick change. You could just use the failover wizard, or you can use T-SQL to force that change in, and it will automatically send log records back to the previous replica.
So again, the scenario might be, I want to apply patches to that server. While I'm doing that, I don't want it to be the primary, so I'll fail over first, apply the patches, and then I might fail back again.
Yeah, exactly. And the final one we have here is a forced manual failover. So if you had a primary replica and a secondary replica that's asynchronous, there's no way for you to, first of all, automatically fail over to an asynchronous partner, and secondly, to fail over without the potential for data loss.
Okay.
So what SQL Server will enable you to do is to force a failover to an asynchronous replica, and you're effectively breaking the replica. So this is your disaster recovery scenario. So we would use a synchronous replica with automatic failover for high availability, and then an asynchronous replica for disaster recovery.
So, and in that case, I need to get the thing back up and running. We talked in the previous module about our recovery time objective. In this case, I need to get something up and running quickly. I can lose a few transactions that might have been lost. And generally speaking, it is going to be a few transactions. We're not talking about hours of activity here.
Yeah.
I can afford to lose those last few transactions in order to get the secondary replica back up and have my application running again.
Yeah, absolutely. So a couple of points on the bottom there. So use the failover wizard within SQL Server to initiate a manual failover. It's nice and easy. We'll have a look at it in a demo. But a key point is not to use failover cluster manager to initiate failover. So you'll see when we have a look at the demo that there are artifacts created in the failover cluster, but it doesn't work the same way as a failover cluster instance. So if you use the Windows failover cluster to manage an availability group, the cluster has no knowledge of checkpoints or clean shutdowns and moving things across. So if you're using Windows to do it, it's basically just a rough stop and throw it across. Whereas if you're using SQL Server, we're going to issue a checkpoint, we're going to take the databases down, we're going to move things across cleanly, a lot of checks and balances to make sure that nothing goes wrong.
Okay, great, good stuff. So let's take a look. We talked about it a long time. Let's take a look at it.
Okay, so I have SQL Server Management Studio set up here. I've got three servers registered, SQL 1, 2, and 3. Before we have a look at the configuration of SQL Server, we'll just have a quick look at Windows Failover Cluster Manager. You can see that we have three nodes in this cluster. They're all up and running. They've all got votes. Remember, we talked about these quorum votes. The fact that I have three means that I'm happy with that.
There's an uneven number of votes.
There's enough to for us to work.
So this is at the Windows level. And again, we just want to keep emphasizing there's Windows clustering, which is what this is here.
Exactly.
And effectively, Windows is saying, I've got these three servers that I'm going to treat as a cluster, and they've got votes to decide whether they've got quorum. It's not aware necessarily that SQL Server is running on these things because we haven't installed a clustered instance of SQL Server. It's just regular SQL Server happens to be on each of these nodes.
Okay. So if we flick back to Management Studio now, let's collapse some of these. So I have a database called People here, which I'm going to put in an availability group. The fact that I've enabled Always On in Configuration Manager means that I now get this, I can expand this high availability artifacts here. And I can right click either one of these and start the high availability group wizard.
Okay.
Which is going to step me through creating an availability group. So first of all, I'm going to create a name. So let's do MVA AG.
Okay.
It's now showing me a list of eligible databases. Now, to be eligible, so we've got meet prerequisites we see there.
Mm-hmm.
The database needs to be in full recovery mode, and it needs to have had a full backup taken. So the reason that it needs a full backup is because we use the full backup as the base of the subsequent log chain.
Right. So in order for me to protect this database using this technique, I need to do a full backup. Now, I guess a question I could ask at this point, this obviously lists all of the databases that you've got on this instance that meet that criteria.
Yes.
It doesn't list any system databases.
That's correct, yeah. So this technology is for user databases only, and you can't protect any of the system databases.
Okay.
So we should probably, yeah, towards the end of the demo, talk about the downside, because it's easy talking about the sexy, exciting bits, but there are lots of caveats, and you know, you have to pay the cost of having these exciting new technologies.
Sure. Okay.
So I'm just going to select people now. So this is the database that I want to put in an availability group. So now I'm presented with a screen where I can add some replicas. So I'm going to add a replica called Coio SQL 02.
And this is on another instance of SQL Server that's on another one of these cluster nodes.
Yeah, exactly. So I'm running a number of virtual machines on my laptop effectively. I've got three virtual machines, Coio SQL 01, 2, and 3.
Okay.
So completely separate Windows servers. So we've got primary, so SQL 01 is the primary here. I'm going to try and select automatic failover here. So you notice that it automatically selected synchronous there, because you can't have automatic failover unless you're synchronous.
Okay.
Okay. And then, so I want these two to be synchronous and automatic failover. They don't have to be automatic failover. They could just be synchronous.
Just be synchronous, yeah.
But I want them to be automatic failover as well.
Okay.
And here I would choose whether they were readable.
Okay.
And I'm going to say I don't want them to be readable, because there I've got my production workload and I've got my failover, and I want them to be dedicated to those roles.
And whichever one is currently the primary obviously is readable, because it's the primary. But as if it becomes a secondary, if we fail over, it's not going to be a readable secondary.
Exactly. Right. And you can see here, actually, a new feature of 2014, adding Azure replica.
Mm.
So within this wizard, I could put another replica up into Azure, which is a nice kind of off-site disaster recovery capability feature. But I'm not going to do that today. So I'm going to add our third node as an additional replica. So now this is grayed out, because I've already got two.
You've got a pair already set up.
I can have it as synchronous,
okay,
but I don't really need it, so I'm quite happy with near real time. But I am going to make it a readable secondary.
Okay.
So we looked at read intent, which is the read-only routing.
Yeah, requiring on that application level knowing about
exactly.
That. Yeah.
So what we could say is this instance will only accept those types of connections, or we could allow anyone that wants to do a read connection in there.
And to get that readable connection, in this instance, they're going to have to connect directly to the instance, not
to
through the shared
SQL
name.
03, yeah.
Okay.
So we've got our replica set up there. So we have a look at the endpoint. So this is what the servers will connect to each other using these endpoints.
Okay.
So we have our backup preferences. So we talked about being able to offload backups. And the default here is to prefer secondary. So we can be... there's a function within... within SQL Server, where you can say, are you the preferred backup replica? So you would have a backup job on each of these replicas that ran at exactly the same time, and only one of them would return yes as being the preferred one, and that's the one that would issue a backup command.
So that way we don't have to keep coming back in. If failover happens, we don't have to reconfigure everything to make sure we're backing up
exactly.
Only the secondary. It just sorts that out.
And we shouldn't need to care where the backup comes from, as long as a backup happens.
Okay.
So we can say prefer secondary, only the secondary. If the secondary is offline, I don't want you to do backups on production, because it may affect availability.
Mm-hmm.
Primary only, or any replica. And you can set backup priorities. So if you've got multiple replicas that are all peers of each other effectively, you can prioritize which ones you'd like to go to.
So perhaps one of the nodes might have additional memory or whatever it may be, additional resources, additional CPUs.
Yeah, or you just want to know that by default that you can monitor that server,
from that.
The backups come from that. And the final tab here we have is the listener. So remember we talked about the listener as being the virtual name and virtual IP address that we would use to connect to SQL Server.
Okay.
And I'm going to create an availability group listener here. Let's call it MVA list. I'm just going to connect on port 1433. I'll need to expand this window. So down here, my resolution's a bit funny. But fortunately, I can just click on that to add an IP address. So I'm going to add an IP address, hopefully one that's available. Let's say 9.
And this is on the same network as your nodes in this case.
Exactly.
I mean, obviously they could have multiple network cards. They could be connected to multiple networks, but effectively this thing is going to appear on the network as if it were a server.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Exactly. So the same as a failover cluster instance, effectively.
Mm.
So I'm going to go for next now. So this is where this is the benefit of the wizard when you're dealing with small databases, where we can get the wizard to set the database up for us.
Okay.
So we're saying a data synchronization preference here. I'm specifying a file share that's accessible by all of the nodes, and the wizard will take a backup of the database, copy it across, restore it on the other nodes for us.
So that's going to get me to that initial state where they all have the same database.
Exactly.
We're ready to start replaying the same transactions across them all.
So for very large databases, you would use some different options because you're going to restore them first and not require this network copy via a wizard. So
that was pretty quick.
That's all worked so far. So hopefully, we finish, expand here, we can see it starting to create the availability group. So it's a really nice and easy, quick thing to do. And, we have a few dozen customers using availability groups, and we've got some customers with 250 to 300 databases in an availability group. So the technology scales quite significantly.
Hmm. Well, again, yeah, pretty quick. So it looks like we're
perfect. So
we're
done. So now we have this MVA availability group primary. So if we expand down here, we can have a look at our replicas.
Mm-hmm.
So SQL01 is the primary. We can have a look at the database. So we've got people, and we can have a look at the listener.
Mm-hmm.
We can also right click and have a look at the dashboard. So the dashboard allows me to see at a glance the state of everything working in here. So you'll notice that the first two have a state of synchronized, and that means that they're in a synchronous replica. The fact that O3 is synchronizing is either synchronous trying to catch up, i.e. there's a problem,
mm-hmm.
Or it's asynchronous.
Right.
So if it's asynchronous, it's always going to be synchronizing. So another tip on here is just in the top right is this view cluster quorum information.
Mm-hmm.
So if we click on here, we can see actually we've got those three nodes and we have a file share witness. So the reason we would do this is so you think about clustering as a high availability technology, but now we have SQL 03 that I'm using for reporting.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm not going to automatically fail over to SQL 03. Therefore, should it really have a vote in the stability of my high availability solution?
Right. So actually, probably not, because to be honest, even if the rest of the cluster goes down, I can still presumably report from that node.
So you can in 2014, but the reason that we would remove this vote is because if you have a reporting server that is being monitored for reporting purposes and something goes wrong with that, you're going to lose a vote in the stability of your high availability platform.
I see. Okay.
So it shouldn't be part of your tightly managed high availability platform. And how we would change that is through the cluster manager. If we come up here and go to to more actions, configure cluster quorum settings. We're going to do an advanced quorum configuration. And we're going to select specific nodes. So I'm going to deselect the third node because it's just for reporting, so I don't want it to have a vote.
Okay. That now leaves me with an even number of servers.
Yeah. And I'm going to configure a file share witness.
Which brings me back to an uneven number of votes so I can
exactly, get quorum. So I've got a file share here sat on the domain controller in my environment here. So once that goes through, we can have a look in here, hopefully, click on here, so we can see the vote has been removed from that node. Because it's just for reporting, I don't really care about it. But now I've created a file share witness, I'm back to this three node system that I'm comfortable with for availability purposes.
So a key takeaway here, I guess, is without wanting to, you know, deviate too much in the conversation, this really is the replacement for a technology that's been around called database mirroring in previous versions of SQL Server, which actually is still there and it can occasionally be useful for some scenarios, but it is deprecated. This is the replacement. And I think that for someone who's moving from database mirroring to this, in database mirroring, it was all SQL Server. Everything was SQL Server. You didn't have to understand anything else.
Yeah.
I think the key takeaway for me here is you're only really going to get the best out of availability groups if you also understand something about how Windows clustering works. So the business of the quorum voting might not be something as a SQL Server DBA you immediately know about, but you kind of have to understand the underlying Windows clustering technology as well as the SQL Server availability group level.
Exactly. So we'll just have a quick, a couple of other things to look at. So we created this availability group listener, if you remember.
Mm-hmm.
So that's say MVA list is how your applications, your users would connect in here. So we can just do a select ATAT server name and we can see that connection is actually running on COIO SQL 01, which is what we were expecting.
So we connected to the listener name as if it were a SQL Server and from the client's perspective, it is. It doesn't know that it's actually connecting to a cluster.
Exactly. And let's go through the process of failover, shall we? Just have a look at the failover wizard before we move on. So you can see here, I can fail over to SQL 02, and it has a little green circle.
Mm-hmm.
That's because it's a synchronous replica. Therefore, I could fail over with no data loss, and it would just replicate back to SQL 01.
Okay.
Or I could force a failover to SQL 03, because it's asynchronous, I can still do it, but it's going to break the availability group. So this is my disaster recovery scenario.
Okay.
But what I'm interested in this case is a synchronous, nice and easy failover. So we're switching over the connection. SQL Server will tell the failover cluster to move the virtual network name to the other node. So we will have a disconnect because
you've disconnected. We've moved. Yeah.
But then if we reconnect again, you'll find that we're now running on SQL 02.
So your client application, you'd want to have, as you would in most client applications anyway, have some retry logic for the disconnect.
Yes,
but exactly. Then it's pretty much after that transparent. The same connection is going to work against the new primary node. Okay.
Yeah. So I could talk about this all day, but I think we might run out of time.
We might want to move on.
Should we get back to the slides?
So that's a really good little quick tour of availability groups. You've got a number of solution examples here of how we might combine some of these technologies together for enterprise availability solutions. So why don't you talk us through some of these?
So these are some interesting examples of architectures that we've worked on and that we've actually developed for our customers. So in this situation, it was a customer, they had two data centers. They were using a failover cluster instances at each data center, and they were using log shipping for disaster recovery.
Okay.
Now, they had a business requirement to test their DR every 6 months. So effectively, every 6 months, they'd switch from running in one data center to be running in the other data center.
Okay.
Okay, so that's fine. But the process for testing that failover with log shipping is quite destructive, and it's a one-way trip, and there's a lot of work to get replicating back.
By
testing DR, you break DR, which can cause a few problems. So the architecture that we developed for this was based on availability groups, where we had an availability group automatic failover in the production we can see at the top, so mm-hmm. it's synchronous and automatic, and this replaces the failover cluster instance that we had at the top. And then we have asynchronous replicas into the disaster recovery environment. And the reason we have two is to enable a fast DR test. So moving on to the next slide, it makes it easy for us to flip the roles of the data centers around and to replicate that traffic back again.
Oh, okay. So you're using, we haven't got a failover cluster here. We've replaced that with availability groups. And effectively, you're using synchronous to give me the automatic failover high availability solution in the primary production environment. I'm using two asynchronous replicas in the disaster recovery environment. Mm. And when I want to flip locations, it's just a question of reconfiguring
changing the roles, because they're already synchronous, already asynchronous, and you can just a quick change to make them synchronous.
Synchronous, yeah. Okay, great. So that's one example of where we might use availability groups. Let's take another look.
So this example, again, there was a web-hosted environment for this customer where they had website users coming to this hosted environment, but they also had a server room in their headquarters where they had a failover cluster. And they used peer-to-peer replication to synchronize data between the website and the back-end ordering systems. And the requirement was to simplify peer-to-peer replication, but can be quite complicated to manage and risk-prone mm-hmm. for making changes. So they wanted us to come up with something that would be easier to support. So what we came up with was this environment where they wanted to move all of their ordering systems into a hosted environment. So they had problems with power outages in their server, somebody digging up the road outside their office mm-hmm. and they can't take orders anymore. So they wanted to move it up into this data center. And what we built is this synchronous replica, as in the previous example, to replace failover clustering. So we've got high availability there. But they also wanted local copy of the data for reporting purposes. So we spun off an asynchronous replica back to their hosted environment or their server in their headquarters, which they could use for near real-time reporting on the data. And this example, they use that as a feed for SSIS to load their data warehouse.
Okay, right, yeah.
And this is a great example. You can see we have a file share witness there, and this is a good example where the third node was used for reporting purposes. And if you were the team that supported that hosted environment there and the availability of the servers that you managed depended on an asynchronous replica in somebody's office that suffered from power outages.
Kick the power out, yeah.
You don't really want that to be part. So we remove the vote from that node and add a file share witness within the data center. So the high availability partnership is self-contained within that data center.
Good stuff. So there's a third example here.
Mm. So this example, we have two different sites. And this is the scenario of multi-site recovery and where the multi-subnet piece comes in. So this customer had a failover cluster at each site. They employed SAN replication to replicate the back end, the databases between the sites. And in the event of a site disaster, they would present the SAN disks and attach the databases, in the DR data center. But their requirement was to remove the dependency on the SAN replication due to cost. They wanted to do the replication at the application tier, so the SQL Server team could support that.
Okay, so
the architecture that we came onto here probably needs a bit of explaining. So what we have here is a four-node Windows Server failover cluster. So we've got two nodes in each site. Mm-hmm. We have shared storage, but only local to each site. So this is technology that, certainly for the exam purposes, is called asymmetric storage.
Okay.
So before we had this technology, if you add a disk to a cluster, it checks to see if you can access the disk from every node in that cluster. Mm-hmm. But now we can say specifically, this is a shared disk, but only between these two nodes. And in the bottom, we've got, this is a shared disk, but only between those two nodes.
I see.
And what we built for them was failover cluster instance at each site, and then an availability group on the top of that. So while I said that failover cluster instances and availability groups are separate, you can combine the two in an advanced deployment scenario. And this is really this replacement for SAN replication for DR.
Mm. Wow, so some pretty sophisticated examples of how we can use all these different technologies together to crack various different problems. So it's been an interesting module in the sense that we've covered a lot of technologies, a lot of different ways to provide high availability and disaster recovery. So we've got the kind of log shipping. I think of log shipping as being good old faithful log shipping. It's been around for a while. It's simple, it isn't broken, it's easy to manage, it has its limitations and you just accept them and live with it. It's a good way to have a database that's available on a standby server by periodically just shipping the transaction log and replaying it there. We then looked at Windows Server failover clustering, which is not a SQL Server technology, it's a Windows technology for combining multiple servers together as a cluster, mm-hmm. and those clusters might share resources. And we might have one of the nodes being the owner of the resource at any one time. But that's a Windows technology, on top of which SQL Server has two different technologies that we can use to implement high availability, where we've got SQL Server always on failover clustering, where we have a shared disk that all of the nodes can access. We install SQL Server as a clustered instance. It's a specific type of installation of SQL Server that only works on a cluster. And that cluster appears on the network as one SQL Server instance. Actually, it's multiple instances, but transparently, if one of those instances goes down, another one will come up and take over the resources and continue working. Mm-hmm. The alternative to that, or not alternative, but the other approach we can take is availability groups, where we are, again, protecting at the database level, but multiple databases can be combined into an availability group. We've got a primary replica and one or more secondary replicas, which can be synchronous or asynchronous. If the replicas are synchronous, then we can get automatic failover between those two, and we won't have any data loss because we've got that synchronous of the transactions across the two. If I've got an asynchronous replica, I can still fail over to it. I might lose the last few transactions that occurred before the failure, and I've got to force the failover, but I can still do that. And I can use the secondaries as a way of offloading workloads from the primary. So I could use them for backups or for reporting or whatever I want to do. And then we looked at some advanced deployment scenarios where we used a combination of these technologies. And we saw several different examples of where they can work together to provide that kind of multi-site scenario for high availability, which is obviously an important solution that large enterprises are looking for, where they have multiple sites. And of course, one of those sites may well be cloud-based. We could be talking about virtual machines in Microsoft Azure, mm-hmm. as well as an on-site data center, and combining the two for high availability. So I hope you found that module useful and interesting. There's some great techniques in there to look at. Again, for the purposes of prepping for the exam, take a good close look at availability groups in particular and the different options you have for setting up availability groups, and look at what's possible and what's not possible when you have synchronous replicas and asynchronous replicas, and how you can use those secondaries. And take a look at the read-only routing, or routing as you would say in America, and make sure that you're comfortable with all of that. Once you've taken your time and got your head around all of that and you're happy with that, come back and join us for the final module, when we'll look at troubleshooting in a SQL Server environment.